Welcome to episode 70 of Think Big with Michael Zellner, all positive, no politics. My guest today is Savio Clemente. Savio is a stage 3 cancer survivor. He's a national board certified health and wellness coach, a syndicated columnist, a podcaster, founder of The Human Resolve, and a number one best-selling author. He has a science of wellness being certification from Yale and a biology of cancer certification from Johns Hopkins. Savio P. Clemente coaches cancer survivors to overcome the confusion and gain clarity and confidence needed to get busy living in mind, body, and spirit. That's a great quote by him. Thanks for joining me today, Savio.
Michael, thank you so much for inviting me. I'm so excited to get started. Thank you.
Tell me something interesting about yourself that most people don't know.
I'm fascinated with space. When I was about 5 or 6 years old, I wanted to be an astronaut. I remember looking up and I had some of the criteria, not all, because I wasn't born in this country. I came in when I was 3 years old. In any event, I really have been saving for the last 6 years, little by little, to eventually take a trip to space. I don't know when that's going to happen, but that's something that most people, unless you're very close to me, you know.
No, you were born in Mumbai, India, and your family moved to America. And when you were just 3 years old, your Catholic elementary school had very small class, just 22 people. What are some of your best memories of that time?
You know, it was there was obviously everyone will talk about it, you know, in terms of their background and their history, that it's just very innocent. But it really was. It was like 22 of us. And I literally grew up with them from first grade to eighth grade. It was Catholic elementary school. I was an altar boy for 5 of those 8 years. And I just remember just feeling very nurtured and loved because, you know, they would have religious service during the classroom sometimes. And so it just seemed like an extension of my own family as well. And it was, I wouldn't say it was completely diverse, but it was diverse in the sense of, well, my family and I were probably the 1% or 2% other, quote unquote, but had really good mix of, you know, Caucasian and African-American. And I just always felt that things were accepting, which really set me up well. So I went to school in Manhattan. And so that really set me up well in terms of just being, you know, culturally diverse in general.
You got your bachelor degree in business administration and information systems from Fordham University in New York City, right where you are. And what did you learn most about yourself when you were in college?
Oh my gosh, my first year was really challenging. I was really inundated with different lifestyles, different behaviors, different individuals. The school that I went to was heavily into liberal arts. So there was a lot of theater majors who were just very dramatic, very loud, very bold, very sure of themselves and confident. And the first year was really challenging. I had to find my way through it. And it was actually emotionally draining for me. I didn't really talk a lot about it, but you would probably wouldn't see it from the surface, but I was really going through a lot of turmoil. I found my way quickly. And eventually I tend to just rise to the occasion when things are really, really dire in my life. But I think what I really loved is just being in the center of, at that point, the world, right? Manhattan, right there, right by Lincoln Center, some great spots. It was very, very safe. And things were just very nurturing. And I had some great professors who taught at not only Fordham, but Columbia and NYU and some of the other great colleges in and around the area.
This is such an important subject, you know, so I want to delve right in. And we talked about it before we came online about it being Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And, you know, I thought you were the perfect guest to have on to talk about cancer since you survived it and you're here to, you know, share your story and help so many other people too. You said, quote, "I almost died in 2014. Hearing those deafening words, 'it is stage 3,' tore me up. But I promised myself that if I made it to the first 5-year remission mark and was still cancer free, that I would make it count," unquote. What are, you know, 3 things that you would tell a person who just learned yesterday that they were have a cancer diagnosis?
So I would say the number one is to figure out for yourself which is the right course of remedy or the right prescriptive course of healing. That comes in varied forms. For me, it was the middle path, what I call, literally in terms of mainstream medicine, along coupling it with integrated modalities. That was just my own choice. So that's number one. You need to figure out what is the protocol and what do you feel comfortable in terms of the protocol and who is going to administer that protocol and whether or not that feels right to you or doesn't feel right to you, second opinion, third opinion, whatever the case may be. You need to know that first and foremost. I think the second thing is to really take stock in who you are as a human and as a being living on this world and this planet, irregardless of your belief system. I know for me, and I've interviewed now close to 200 cancer survivors, so I know there's a couple of singular threads that run through, and that is really this idea that even though your physical body is diseased and maybe at some point dying, the rest of you, the emotional aspect of you, the spiritual aspect of you, the vibrational aspect of you, all those things that people learn in Eastern medicine is still alive. So you need to figure out a way for that to mirror what's lacking in your life in terms of the disease itself. And I would say third is really trying to figure out for yourself, what is it that you would like to do once you get through the cancer? I think it's really important to figure out a vision for yourself and to try to inch your way and crawl your way towards that vision. And that could come in different forms of journaling, writing, visioning, talking with loved ones, family members. I think that's really crucial and key.
You said, when you said it tore you up, you obviously, you were very determined to beat this. You know, what did you do to feel empowered to fight your cancer?
So Michael, my cancer diagnosis came fast and furious. I literally was told to get a sonogram. I got the sonogram. They wouldn't let me leave the office. I was told to go see a doctor an hour later after the sonogram, told to go to the hospital. Literally within 45 minutes, they admitted me to the fifth floor. And that night I heard whisperings that I would be transferred to the seventh floor, which they called the cancer floor. So I had an idea what was happening to me. My breath was belabored. And also my stomach, I was sort of growing distended. It was growing larger and larger. So I knew something was definitely wrong. I think for me, really the key element here in all of this mess is the fact that I was armed with information and knowledge. I truly believe to heal thyself is to know thyself. And so for me, I didn't understand what a Hodgkin's lymphoma or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma was, but I researched. I had Wi-Fi access and I literally researched high and low for some of the answers. I created a Google alert so I could understand. I asked many questions to the many doctors who were there, but I didn't really have a choice to seek care elsewhere. It was fast and furious, and I was told 3 days out of the 2 weeks that I was there that I needed to start my first round of chemo. So I really separated self, and I know this sounds really weird to most people, but I really saw myself and my disease as a stranger. In other words, I separated the Savio that was there attached to a nephrostomy tube that was bedridden for the first week and the Savio that wants to create, wants to love, wants to grow, wants to live. And I try to figure out a way to get to that version of Savio as opposed to the one who's sick and dying.
And you took charge right away. I mean, to do that and to go online while you're sitting there, while you're laying there in the bed to do that, that's powerful.
Yeah. I mean, I just felt to myself because I had to get a bone marrow aspiration. And apparently those things are extremely painful. And I remember two of the doctors who administered to me said, like, you didn't whimper at all. And I'm like, I told them, I'm like, and they're like, we just told you have stage 3 cancer. And I'm like, docs, what am I supposed to do? I'm not that personality that just crumbles. I'm someone who, okay, well, what's next? And if I can't get to next, that doesn't matter. It's that I try to get to next. And so that's just kind of the way I'm wired. I think my life experiences have set me up really well with dealing with something as big and as bold as cancer.
Robert B. said, quote, over the last 10 years, I've had the opportunity to build a true friendship with Savio. I've seen him offering a helping hand to countless people without looking for anything in return, unquote. You know, when you give of yourself, you know, without expecting something in return, your entire focus is on the recipient. It's such a selfless act. And unfortunately, in today's world, it's very rare. Have you always been such just a genuinely caring person?
I think I've always been concerned about the welfare of others. Even when something's really bad or worse or tragic has happened in my life, irregardless of cancer, I always thought to myself that it could always be worse. And I know as a coach, that's not maybe the right answer to say. As always, people want empathy, people want compassion. Sure. But I think for me, I kind of look at it, we're dealt with what we're dealt with, whether you believe in some notion of anything. You know, there's so many people talk about karma and people talk about cause and effect and people talk about all these things. Whether you believe in it or you don't believe in it, the fact of the matter is we are challenged in this life. Nobody gets away with anything in terms of, you know, we have scars to prove it. And so I think it's our job to figure out a way through it, because just as maybe we created it, we can uncreate it. So to answer your question, I think for me, I've tried my best. I made mistakes. I failed many times. But I just promised myself that as long as I give what I can give to others and be as selfless as I can, and to really practice that in a very genuine way, not in a very sort of give and take sort of way. And that's fine if that's something that someone wants to do. It's totally great. I mean, I believe energy for energy as well. But I think when you always expect, it's very rare that you'll get.
I agree with that. You know, having the support of close family and friends is important, but, you know, it's probably even more important when someone's dealing with cancer. You know, what did others, you know, close to you do for you after your diagnosis that made a difference for you?
Okay, so I'm chuckling a little bit because to this day, Michael, it's now, this December will be 8 years since I've been in remission. I was diagnosed in 2014. My extended family, cousins, aunts, and uncles still don't know I had cancer. And it was a choice I made at the time. So my parents know, I have two sisters, they know, their spouses know, their kids know. But I felt shame with cancer. I felt I didn't want to be a zoo animal because I knew I would be bedridden for about 2 weeks. And so to a large degree, they offered, but I was, I saw cancer as a challenge that I only could face, that it was a fire that I only could pass through. And I'm very grateful because literally after going through 6 hours in a chemo bed, you are wiped out. You really need someone to pick you up. So my dad offered. I lost about 13 pounds when I came out of the hospital in those 2 weeks. My mom looked at me. She said, no, we need to change this. So they definitely were supportive in that, but I didn't really lean on a lot of people. And in hindsight, after launching my book, which launched this February, I highlighted 35 of those 200 stories and told my own. Another core element that I found was when people help you, it's like they're doing something that you can't do. So it's not about them doing something for you. It's about them carrying the load, so to speak. And so do I wish that I did more of that? I think I probably didn't emotionally unravel all the things that cancer brought to my life. I think I just did it the best way I knew how. So,
yeah. Everybody's going to handle it differently, aren't they?
Yes, 100%. I mean, some people need a family member to lean on and to, you know, be their scribe and to carry the burden and to make them feel like they're helping you, even though they don't know what to say or what to do. And I totally think that's beautiful. But I know back in 2014, I was just wired differently. And now I think if it happened to me, I hope it doesn't happen to me again, because there's no such thing as being cured from cancer. You're only no evidence of disease. I think I would just be more guttural with it in terms of letting it really stick to my bones. I think I saw it as an enemy and something I needed to beat and overcome.
Nick Lynch, who is one of the cancer survivors that you featured in your book, which we'll talk about more today, said, quote, "Seek normalcy. The minute you hear your cancer diagnosis, nothing is the same. You feel people treat you differently. The things you do on a daily basis change, and it's easy to feel that the life you had is gone before it's gone," unquote. You know, Savio, what are some of the things that you do for the people that you work with that help them, you know, change their mindset?
You know, I think the number one key is this idea of labeling. So you can actually take the label of a cancer patient, a cancer survivor, and empower yourself with it. So in other words, it doesn't have to be a moniker or something that someone assigns to you. It could be a superpower. It could be the fact that you came through something as disastrous and as devastating, a blow as cancer is to a lot of people. So I think that's number one. I think number two is really to dig deep into this idea of resiliency and using the actual word transformation, which is sort of the ability to rise above sort of the pain or rise above the circumstance in a very healthy way, not in a very magical way. And so a lot of the coaching that I do is really getting people to understand that your past creates your present and figuring out what that new normalcy will look like, what that 2.0 version, as a client once said to me, would look like. So I think those are really the keys that we, you know, draw upon. I am certified in, various modalities. One of them is sort of this idea of the three brains, which is the head, heart, and gut. If you do a lot of research, science has shown some evidence that they emit some type of consciousness. It's not just our heads that are always thinking. It's the heart that sort of leans in and the gut that actually gives us some of our best insights, so to speak. So that takes a lot of practice, a lot of knowing. It's about self-reflection, but also, you know, various other ways and means to tap into that, which is meditation, journaling, and also just being quiet and still with self. And I think that's the hard part for most people. I had four roommates in my hospital. And one of them was just really sweet and really nice. His son stayed with him literally like all night for like weeks. I had three other roommates who wanted to get the hell out of there. And I think people handle the scare very, very differently. And so I think really the key is to really come to terms with who you are as a person and how is it that you're able to transform or overcome or find the light that is at this moment in time being darkened.
When you said that they wanted to get the hell out of there, were they ready to get the hell out of there because they wanted to get out there and fight it? I'm ready to get out of this hospital. Or were they just scared? They didn't know what to do.
Yeah. I asked one of them, I'm like, what? Because he literally was screaming and yelling at the nurses and the doctors, even though the next morning he had a radiation appointment. And I asked him, I said, listen, I know it's none of my business, but what are you rushing home for? And he's like, well, I have my dogs there. And I'm like, but I said, I don't want to pry, but I can hear, but you have a radiation appointment tomorrow. He's like, no, no, no. And then I talked to a friend and she's like, Savio, you don't get it. I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, this is cancer. You have a different mindset with it. You handling it differently. They're thinking they're going to die. They don't want to die in a hospital. And I'm like, oh my God, you're right. And that was a big lesson for me. Cause I'm like, oh God, that's true compassion, is to actually meet people where they are in the moment, not what you think that they are or what you think they should do. So
that's a big deal right there, what you just said. That's huge.
Yeah, it is. It is huge. Cause I was looking at it from my point of view, like the hospitals are for healing. The nurses are helping you. The doctors are helping you, but I'm not living in his mind and in his bones. I'm not seeing and feeling his fear. I'm not seeing and feeling dread. I'm not, you know, I'm not seeing and feeling what radiation may do to his body. I'm not thinking in that sense. And so it was a really great eye opener and very, very, it was like a snap. You know, when someone snaps their fingers, it really woke me up to understand that my path is my own. And you know, people walk the way they walk.
Now you have what you call, quote, my secret sauce, unquote. And you said, quote, I can scan a room and look for a solution to any problem. And I am obsessed with dreaming of things that could be, unquote. Can you please share with us just a little bit about how your secret sauce works?
Yeah. So, as you alluded to, I graduated from Fordham University. I graduated with information systems, fancy way of saying just computers. And with the business administration background, I did a lot of work for various hundreds of brands where I did innovation. And so for me, coaching is just another realm. It's just dealing. That's why I call my website the Human Resolve, because I want humans to come back to who they are, not their labels, not their titles. And so I've just had this sort of knack. I mean, it sounds a little boastful, so I apologize for that. But I do have this knack where I'm like in a room, I'm very observant, like super keen. And I just try to figure out things to do better or to optimize or to recreate. It's just something that's just very innate in me. When it comes to coaching, it sometimes gets me in trouble because I'm like two steps ahead, and you can't be two steps ahead with your client. You have to be in the moment, present with your client. I do have this knack of doing it. So I'm not like Bill Gates or even the Apple founder.
Steve Jobs.
Yeah. I'm not Steve Jobs. I don't have like 300 patents, but I do have ideas that I write in a journal and I keep it to myself. So, yeah.
You feel like that's a little bit of intuitiveness with you?
I think it's a little bit of intuitiveness, and I think it's a little bit of dissatisfaction. Like, I can be really, I think one of the main, if someone was to ever ask me, what do you think, and I'm putting myself in the equation, us humans really make a mistake with, and I think it's the fact that we're too subjective. We cannot be objective even with ourselves. And I can be completely objective with myself. I can literally separate myself in any situation and say, that was messed up. You need to stop and you need to redirect. And I can do that very quickly. And I think to a large degree, I think that's just sort of filtered its way when dealing with people and humans. I just always feel like, to a large degree, things can always be better because I try to constantly challenge myself. A good friend once said 20 years ago, and I live this motto every day, that we're here to polish the facets of our character. That's what we're here for. So I try to make attempts to do that. Sometimes I'm successful and sometimes I'm not, but I try.
This is an excerpt from your book, quote, "True transformation is not granted through wishful thinking, but through willful action," unquote. What does that mean to you?
You know, I think a lot of people feel and want want their, their needs and their emotions satisfied in terms of saying you can beat this, you're a fighter, cancer's not going to get you. And I think those are all wonderful. You need cheerleading in your life, especially when it comes to cancer. You need to know there's hope out there. But I think when it comes to cancer, just from my perspective and interviewing as many people as I have, and now having a best-selling book with cancer survivors, doing podcasts with cancer survivors, coaching cancer survivors, I think really the key crux of all of this is the fact that you need to be in action of something. You can't just hope. And of course, miraculous things do happen. So I'm not negating that at all. But you need to be in some sort of action. Whatever that action is really up to you. You need to figure out for yourself. Because healing doesn't always take place in a doctor's office. It doesn't always take place in a chemo bed. Doesn't always take places in anything biohacking and I cop to it. I do a lot of biohacking things with myself and with my body. It happens in those quiet moments. It happens at night. It happens when you're just daydreaming. It happens when you're in so much pain, you can't move. It happens with neuropathy, when things are sort of stopping in terms of your hands or your feet. It happens in those quiet moments. And so that's the action. The action is, well, what's precipitating this? How can I maybe figure out a different way to move about my life? And what is it that I can do to get myself closer to that vision of overcoming?
You've interviewed several big celebrities, including Ice-T, Debra Messing, Carlson Kressley, and probably my favorite out of all of them is Venus Williams. And, Venus and Serena not only were amazing tennis players, but they also were so good for the game, a much needed time. They have such a presence about themselves. They're just so spectacular. I bet that was probably a lot of fun for you. Was there anything that surprised you that you learned? And what was your biggest take from that interview?
So a couple of my friends and family members say to me, "Oh my God, like, are you nervous around these people?" And I am in great reverence of their star quality in terms of what they produced and the fact that they're well known for what they produced in the world. But at the end of the day, I think coaching and interviewing as many people as I have, I just see them as everyday people with problems, either larger or smaller, maybe a different way or a different facet of it. So I think really the main thing I learned from all that is the fact that, coming from a journalistic standpoint, doing what I do, they're nervous around me because I have the power of the pen. And so they're just afraid of what they're going to say. So there's a lot of hesitancy to some degree. And sometimes there's a lot of like acting or boastfulness in their approach. But I've been told that I have a way about me that just makes people feel comfortable. And so really the key element there is that people just melt in just being who they are in and around me. And I think I find that fascinating because given their star status and what people expect or know of them, at the end of the day, they just want to be loved. They just want to be accepted. And they just really want to, leave this planet a little brighter than, where they came from.
I didn't think about that, the hesitancy you just talked about, that makes sense. Like, of course, they're going to be hesitant when they're being interviewed, especially today's world with social media and everything. People jump on every little thing you say. So that makes sense.
Yeah. And, you know, their PR reps are right next to them too. So, I mean, I've never had it where they've stopped me for anything. I mean, I've had it where they wanted questions in advance and sure. they said, please don't ask that question. That's totally fine. But I've never had it where they stopped me because I know how to draw the lines. I mean, I think it helps that I'm a coach and I'm helped that I interview people because I think those two create this equilibrium for them to feel like they can say what they want to say, but not blur the lines, so to speak.
You know, it's funny that you say that about, you know, I've interviewed some people and they've asked, hey, you know, do you need me to submit any information about myself? Or, you know, and most people, there's a few people that I have asked because, you know, I just couldn't find anything on them, you know, online in detail and I wanted to know more. But there's some people that I've talked to that, you know, pretty well known. And I know that there has been some things that maybe they didn't want to talk about. So I asked them ahead of time, is there anything that you just rather not talk about? Because I just thought that was the right thing to do.
Yeah, I actually, like, when I first started interviewing, like, pretty well-known, recognizable individuals, my editor was like, okay, Savio, like, it's great that you're asking them things about their life, but remember, you're interviewing them, you're not coaching them. I'm like, oh, so I had to, like, literally shift mindset. I'm like, oh, wait, I'm in a different space. Because, you know, if people ask me what I do, I always say I'm a board-certified wellness coach because I love coaching. I love this idea of creating that space for individuals to free themselves because there's a difference between coaching and therapy and people blur the lines. Therapy, not always, but most of the time, it's about going to the past, figuring out things, right? And then figuring out how is it that you're going to sort that out. And coaching is really about the present into where you want to go. What's happening with your life? What is it that you want to create? What is it that you want to, you know, reinvent? And to a large degree, I remember just being fascinated with their lives and what they were saying that I was like, wait, I have to take a step back and ask them questions like, tell me a story or give me an example or how did this. And so my recent interview with Debra Messing, she has a show, a movie on Netflix. And so I asked her a question, how does the character mirror her life? And she literally opened up. It was such a beautiful conversation. It wasn't rehearsed. She had no idea. And she really talked about herself and how that character really mirrors her own life. And I thought that was just a beautiful answer.
I just saw the episode that she was on. She was on a couple episodes of Seinfeld back in the day. So I just saw it recently. It was on TV. Yeah, I've always liked her a lot.
Yeah.
Quote, professional, honest, loyal, and giving. Savio always has a shoulder and ear for anyone in need. He goes out of his way to help others and has been there for me on numerous occasions, unquote. Very kind words spoken about you by Regina F. You know, many cancer survivors experience distress, anxiety long after completing treatment. How important is it for a cancer survivor to have people just to talk to and just listen to them sometimes?
Most of my coaching conversations are just listening. Really, it is. I mean, there's a lot of breakthroughs that happen. I mean, my program, I have a 3-month program. It's not for the faint of heart. It's really about the fact that something bad happened to you. So now what is it that you want to do with your life? And to a large degree, it was very nice of my friend Regina to say that, you know, about me because I wanted some, you know, character references. But, you know, I think it goes back to what I mentioned in general. It's nice to hear, but when I hear it, sometimes there's a disconnect because I feel like I could always do better, right? And so that's that part of me that always feels that way. But I do accept it, I do realize it, and I'm very thankful and grateful for it. But I think really the key is when it comes to cancer survivorship in general is that people assume that once you survive cancer, you're one of the lucky ones. Let's tend to the people who are currently in the situation. Of course, that's paramount. I'm not taking away from that. But there's life before cancer and life after cancer. And until you've gone through it, you don't know what happens. Your whole mindset, your whole energy, your whole relationship to self changes. And if you're someone who has to have a dire cancer where things like your throat was taken away or your breast was taken away or whatever the case may be, it's shocking. And that creates sort of this idea of feeling, well, why am I still alive and why are my friends not? Or this feeling of, this is scary. I don't know how to continue. And so that's really a large part of what I do, which is this idea of, you know, seeing yourself as something greater than who you were before the cancer itself.
You know, when talking about your coaching philosophy, you know, regarding the process, you said, quote, unlike a therapist, mentor, and consultant who dispenses advice, I assist in finding your own breakthroughs, unquote. I really like that. What are some of the ways that you do that for people?
Yeah. So that's the number one thing about coaching, which I love, is the fact that coaching is not about telling people what to do. Now, there's sports coaching, which is a whole different thing. Right. But in terms of the realm of coaching, and to the layman, all my background and all my certifications mean nothing. But in the coaching world, it's pretty much the pinnacle. I'm board certified, I'm ICF certified, which basically means that I know the realms or the contours of how to coach properly. And really the essence of coaching is really allowing people, asking the right questions, reflecting, and having people realize what it is the answer is. Because when you realize the answer yourself, you're able to apply it, and then you're able to let it sink in, and you're able to grow from it. It's not about me telling them. Now, of course, sometimes, right, there's things where I can suggest things and whatnot. But coaching is really that fine line of you figuring out your own breakthrough so that you can actually take that and use that and apply that and grow with that.
You said, quote, "My personal philosophy can be summed up in three words, get busy living," unquote. Describe to us what those three words mean to you.
Well, it was taken from my favorite movie, Shawshank Redemption, where where Red goes, get busy living or get busy dying. And so for me, I promised myself if I had 5 years, I would do something with it. I didn't know. I swear to you, I had no idea it was coaching. When I used to hear of people being life coaches, I'm like, what are you, this person, how are they coaching someone who themselves can't figure out their own stuff? But I realized it's about the process. It's about you're a few steps ahead of most people, that sort of thing, and helping them get to where they want to go. And so for me, it's really making this promise to myself that I was going to do whatever I can, even though it's hard and difficult and I doubt myself, imposter syndrome and all those things. And I was just going to move one inch every day towards that, you know, full realization. So it's really about figuring out what is it makes me happy. So a few things make me happy, you know, travel makes me happy. Coaching makes me happy. Helping people makes me happy. You know, entertainment makes, you know, these things, these like simple things. But to me, I want to create, I want to sort of break through some of the noise within myself and figure out, well, you know what does make you happy? And how can you get closer to that every single day?
One of the 35 survivors that you interviewed in your book, Eve McDavid, said, quote, "Prepare to celebrate every single win. Staying positive all the time is hard. So find ways to recognize the good and raise it up," unquote. How important is it for cancer patients and survivors, you know, just to have the right mental mindset?
It's paramount. Like I mentioned to you earlier, I think just, you know, I've always been someone who's kind of challenged the norm. So I grew up in an Asian Indian household, came in when I was 3 years old, pretty much sheltered to most degree. I was the only boy out of a family of three. So I have two older sisters. And I went to school in the big city and things sort of changed. And I was not afraid to tell my parents that even though I grew up Catholic, that just wasn't the right thing for me. I wanted to look to, you know, learn about other, you know, belief systems. That was a big thing. I came out as openly gay in my, you know, sophomore year of college. So that was a big deal as well for them. And just generally just being someone who's just on the go and just extremely independent. I think for me, I really set myself up to figuring out that I was the only one who can get me out of any situation there is. Of course, I leaned on family and friends for different parts and moments of my life. And they were very extremely helpful, especially in certain areas of, you know, when you're young, you just make some bad financial decisions. Sure. And so they sort of, you know, bailed me out with that. But to some degree or to a large degree, I've always kind of realized that no one can kind of save me. I need to save myself.
It's exactly what I was thinking right before you said that, that probably, you know, I've heard that so many times as far as like mental health, wellness in general, but I was thinking to myself that probably applies to exactly what you're just talking about, even with cancer survivors too.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's important to have a cheerleader or to have people who are rooting for you or who are supporting you. And some people need that more than others. And I think that's very important. But at the end of the day, and I told someone who actually reached out to me after reading one of my articles, and she lived in India and she exhausted a couple of, you know, resources, and she wanted me to call and do all these things. And I'm like, as a journalist, I have journalistic integrity and I can't fish for information. You can do it as a layman, but that's really, and I said to her, and it might've sounded a little harsh, but I was, because she was going on. I said, it's cancer versus you. I can't take that load for you. It's your cross to bear. So you need to figure out with all the knowledge and all the access and all the resources, you need to walk the walk. I can't do that for you because everyone is burdened with what they're burdened to in this life, whatever that is.
Quote, I found that sometimes the answer can only be found when you stop searching, unquote. You know, that's really profound. How did you come to that conclusion?
You know, I think it was, I think I'm going on 22 years of meditating. I do it religiously. If I don't do it, and I have not done it a couple times, I felt awful. Like something's off. Like it's not even my mind telling me that. It's actually my physicality, my presence in the world. And I think meditation beyond, and it doesn't have to be something formal like lotus position. That's great if you want to do mantras and hum and do like, you know, mudras, which is, you know, like fingers on fingers. Whatever you want to do, it could just be as easy as what I do, which is lie down, instrumental music, and just kind of, you know, go into that quiet space. I think the quiet space is really the answer for a lot of people, because I think people like the noise. I think people like the confusion, even though they say don't want the confusion. They like not having to make a decision. And when you're with self, you only are there with yourself. There's no one else that you can lean or make excuses for or say this or say that. And I think that's the hard part for most people. And so for me, it was a little easier because I've had the experience, so to speak, of being more quiet with self than anything else.
I have one of my best friends, his name is Greg Graber. He's actually a mindfulness trainer and mindfulness coach. He works with, you know, high school students, college students, athletes, teams, and, you know, and he actually, when I said to him at the beginning 6 years ago, when I met him, or 7 years ago, I said, does this stuff really work? And he said, look at the Chicago Bulls, you know, Phil Jackson, you know, back in the 90s, and, you know, and the meditation, and LeBron meditates and Kobe meditates. He goes, it works.
Yeah. I mean, it's really, I think people try to make it more complex than it is. And I tell people all the time, because, you know, a lot of my coaching, it's really about finding resources and tools. It's not about me telling them because they figure it out themselves. But if they don't know the answer, it's about sort of inching them to realize the answer. And a large part of this is it doesn't have to be 10 minutes on an app. It could just be as minute as 1 minute a day that you build off of, just like you build when you go to a gym and you don't hit the 150-pound weight, you hit the 10-pound weight and you build off of that. And so it takes practice, it takes a willingness, and it takes actually discipline and commitment. And, you know, I falter sometimes with my own discipline in other ways. But that's a non-negotiable to a large part of my life, is this idea of meditating. And then I also add a little bit of affirmative statements, just generally to just allow myself to be in that presence. I had a guest on my podcast about a few months ago, and he mentioned, I thought he said something really keen in it. It was so simplistic. He's like, I don't think prayer and meditation is about sort of saying things or doing things. It's about coming to that space. That's your entry point. And I'm like, wow, that is so true. That's where the magic happens. It's that leads you to the entryway. It's not about doing it because you want to get something out of it. It's about leading you to that arena or that area.
You said, quote, as coach, I know the number one hindrance to change, the fear of what the unknown may bring. So I did what every self-help guru says you shouldn't. I hid. I hid from opportunities. I hid from meeting new people. I also hid from myself. But this year, the tone is different. I decided to take the bold step and not hide any longer, unquote. You know, I've done the same too. And so it hit many times. So it hit home with me, and I understand exactly what you did and why you did it. You know, was there something that finally just clicked inside of you for you just decide to make that change, or was it a series of events?
No, I think it was, now it's a process. So it's not like I, you know, all of a sudden became, you know, XYZ. Like I known being seen is a big deal for me, and people who know me and people who've seen me and people who don't know me, who just know me, can't believe what I'm saying, but it's true. I literally just did a video podcast. I started that about like 4 months ago. It's the first time people really see me. Then I did a whole, people were inviting me as a guest on their podcast. So of course some of them have video. Because I'm great with behind the scenes, right? Working in IT and doing project management and doing all these things. I'm great at doing that. I'm great at writing. I'm great at coaching. Those are all hidden things. But I think really the end of the day, nothing is more jarring than knowing that your time is up. And as a cancer survivor, you are very clear-minded that your time is louder than others. So in other words, even though you're in remission, no evidence of disease, whatever that is, you do know that you are maybe closer to that finality. And so therefore you challenge yourself, or you become very bold and say, well, what else do I have to lose? I have to do this. Otherwise, it doesn't really matter, does it?
Now, people that get cancer, you talked about how they're more prone to get it again, you know, sometimes. I mean, if it goes completely, and I'm asking this because I just don't know, if it goes completely away and there's no sign of it anymore, why is it much easier for it to come back to them? Is it something about them that just makes it easier where it can come back than someone who's never had it?
You know, my second interview series, I interviewed doctors. So at this point, I think I interviewed about 125 doctors. And the interview series was five things you need to know from a doctor's perspective about cancer. And, you know, they tell you all the science stuff, and that's fantastic. And that's great. But most of the time, including my own cancer, I had no history of it on both sides of my family. They just are clueless, or, you know, don't know really. Obviously, some behavioral and lifestyle things will affect your chances of maybe getting a very common, let's say, cancer. But in terms of recurrence, that is a tricky thing, because I don't think anyone has an idea or has an answer. And I think it's left that way on purpose, because I think to a large degree, it's for you to figure out what is the best way to navigate the new road, and what is it that you can maybe change and alter that wasn't really working well, or that was rocky in your progress towards fulfillment. We all want happiness. We all want fulfillment. We all want to be loved. And I think sometimes, I can only speak to my own self. At that time when I had cancer in 2014, I was going through a really hard, emotionally draining business relationship with three other individuals. And to be honest with you, Michael, I had no courage to stand up for myself. I was cowardice. It just didn't end well. And I didn't take it upon myself to be bold and to be brave. As you know, Brene Brown says, I was afraid to be in the arena. I was afraid. And I'm not saying that was the main reason I had cancer. I think that was a confluence of things. But since then, I think the idea of, you know, recurrence is really to a large degree fear-based, because you don't know. And a large portion of us, especially myself, will sometimes get very antsy when I know, you know, when we know we have a test coming up, or when we know we have, like now I see my oncologist yearly. Before it was every 3 months, then every 6 months, and every 9 months, and now it's every year. And so I think it's, I think you just need to do the best you can to keep it at bay. And whatever those things are, or ingredients are, is for you to figure out, and not for a self-help guru, or even a doctor, or even a priest, or even a spiritual advisor to tell you. I think it's for you to really figure out for yourself how to keep yourself healthy as possible.
You know, you have so many different certifications from different organizations and prestigious universities all across the country. So your credentials are incredible. You traveled to many places throughout the world, covered many major events, you know, including the Global Wellness Summit, and you fought for human rights. How have the places that you've gone, the people that you've seen, all the people, you know, the certifications, the universities, everything that you've accomplished, how in your journey, how has it helped you in what you do now?
Oh, yeah. I'm so happy you asked this question, because to a large degree, I knew that if I was going to go this route, that I wanted to be armed with not only knowledge, not only experience, but a true understanding of what it takes to take someone on that journey. Because coaching is about, it's a relationship. We're actually going somewhere together. And so I just wanted to figure out for myself that if I was going to do this, I was armed with enough information to adequately let that process unfold properly. And maybe I went a little overboard, and you know, they call it within my cohorts with the different certifications and different, you know, credentials I got, you know, there's something called a certification train. And that is actually true. You get one out of the other. And large part of it is also you have to examine self and see, is there imposter syndrome? Do you feel that you're not worthy to be in front of other people? It's a lot of stuff going on. But at the end of the day, if you want to be a full-time coach like I am, you need to like walk the walk, and you need to actually at one point press pause on the certifications, because you can always get them some other time, and just do the work and to be of service to other people. And that's really the key.
You know, you started your company, the Human Resolve, a little bit over, you know, I believe 2.5 years ago. And your tagline is unlock the courage within. You know, I checked out your website. It's really impressive. You know, tell us a little bit about some of the different things that you do with your business and some of the services that you offer cancer survivors that really can help change their lives, you know, both in the short term and long term.
Yeah, the tagline was really a call to arms for myself. It was a motto. It was a clarion call to some degree to find my own courage. And so the graphic was a clear representation that there's something in the middle. So my logo is like a heart, sort of. And so there's like a box in the middle, and the box is really that courage, which then also mirrors this idea of your gut, which is when you do understand embodiment and you do understand, somatics, which is the use of the body, that is the seat of courage is your gut. It's really like a knowing feeling. And a large portion of society know it as, I have that gut feeling, I have that sensation. Beyond that, it's really my 3-month coaching program. I really get really involved in people and their lives, and I want to see them excel. So we go through this whole process of just unfoldment and realization. And I have examples on my website where, my podcast, I did something unique with it, basically did a 30-minute coaching session with cancer survivors on any topic they want. I didn't even know what they were talking about until they came on, because I'm very good at just the unfamiliar. I'm very good at my program. I have my son out as well. The soft cover is coming out at the beginning of 2023, because I wanted to sort of halt that a little bit. I also had the podcast, listen to the information as well. I have my interview series. So my first interview series, which was the impetus of the book, was called I Survived Cancer, Here's How I Did It. At the point, there's about 200 interviews. I release about 15 to 20 interviews a week on different topics like resilience, fear of failure. I also cover different travel and wellness experiences. So I do a lot of as well. It's another way to garner or gain more information. I have a newsletter on my website. You can sign up. And I really, really test this idea of head, heart, and gut with my own life. If working and not working in my life, I'm very honest about what it is and what isn't, in the hopes that someone can glean that information and find some type of resolve in their own life. And most of that information obviously could be found on my website, which is thehumanresolve.com. And from there, you can click on my book website, which is called isurvivedcancer.co.
And that's the book, I Survived Cancer and Here's How I Did It. 35 cancer survivors share their journey. Your number one best-selling book. We talked about, you interviewed 175 cancer survivors. I can't imagine how difficult it must have been for you to get down and just to choose just 35 to put in your book. And you said, quote, "I wanted to highlight what they learned physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually from this very difficult experience, which has forever shaped their worldview," unquote. You have some really great 5-star reviews on your book. I want to read one of them. Pat Wetzel said, quote, "This book is about hope. Savio has done a beautiful job of offering hope and wisdom through the stories of these 35 people. One of the most difficult things about cancer is the intense isolation that goes with the experience. This book provides the companionship one seeks and knowing that none of us are alone in this experience," unquote. You know, I can imagine you interviewing 175 cancer survivors, there probably were some very emotional moments, very compassionate moments that you shared together, because since you're a survivor yourself, I would guess that probably wasn't just the easiest thing to do. Even if you step out a little bit, I mean, the kind of guy that I can tell that you are, you gotta be, you feel that compassion and you know where people are coming from with this. Can you just share a little bit about, that experience with those people, putting this book together and how all this process came about?
Yeah. Yeah. I have to give credit to my editor. He basically said, after the interview series and getting all those interviews, said, "Savio, this needs to be a book." He's like, "You can only see it from your perspective, but from my back end perspective, this is a movement you're creating. So you need to do something with it and create a book." And so I was very intentional. I'm someone of color. So I wanted to make sure that diversity was represented. I want to make sure that diversity of cancers were represented. I have throat cancer, colon cancer. It's a lot of breast cancer, because unfortunately it affects a lot of women. And there was a lot of stories there. I also wanted to highlight what they went through and what they learned, like the kernels and the morsels that I found very intriguing. Because one of the main questions I ask in my interview series, which is also included in my book, is, if cancer had a message for you, what would it say? And some of them were like, what? I didn't even think of it as outside of myself. I didn't even think that's even possible. And it really challenged them to think deeper about, well, what is cancer maybe showing you that you didn't see? Or what is cancer maybe highlighting that you need to take a look at? And so for me, it was hard. And I actually really felt like emotionally and viscerally that I was carrying the 35 survivors. Like I felt like it was a mission. I literally felt it in my bones. And it was a lot of workup, and I made sure that I did whatever I could, but there was a lot of energetic output that I did because I felt to a large degree, if I don't present this in the right way, then the message will be lost on people, that there could be one person, just one person out there who could maybe say, I didn't think of that, and maybe change course or direction or gain wisdom and insight in order to better themselves and their community.
What are the most important lessons you've learned in your life?
I think one of the most important lessons is the fact that we are given tasks. We are given challenges. We are given happiness. We're given opportunities and tools. And I think it's our job to try to shake, rattle and roll outside of what we consider familiar, what we consider normal, and figure out how other people are living, because in that we will come to understand what our purpose is in this world. And I think purpose is a big word, and I don't really use it in my coaching because I think the idea of purpose really makes people feel there's a finality aspect to it. What I like to sort of get people to understand and to realize is the fact that your everyday is a purpose. It's not about a final destination. It's about doing and being and living and spreading. And really the basic tenets of that is work and love.
How can people find you and follow you on social media?
So they can go to my website, thehumanresolve.com. And from there, I'm on Twitter at @thehumanresolve. I'm on Instagram @thehumanresolve. I'm on LinkedIn at Savio P. Clemente. I don't really use Facebook just because I don't have a certain amount of bandwidth for that. But I'm also on TikTok @thehumanresolve as well.
Where can people pick up a copy of your number one bestselling book?
They can go to Amazon. It's in a couple of stores right now as well. It's available. Just search I Survived Cancer and you'll find it there. You can go to my website. I have a book link. You could also watch the book trailer. It's a 5-minute book trailer where I highlighted, I think, 12 So the individuals who did my interview series also submitted a YouTube video. And so there was a compilation and I tried to tell the story as best as I could.
You know, what you're doing and what you've done for cancer survivors, you know, it really can't be put into words. You know, it's apparent from all these, you know, wonderful things, you know, people have said about you and in your book, what you're doing, you're changing lives for the better. I know that must be, you know, a really incredible feeling for you knowing that what you're doing is making a difference. And I can't even imagine, you know, that feeling that you have, the feeling that the people have that maybe weren't there before and they couldn't figure out how to get there and you crossed them over that finish line and got them there. That has to be just a great feeling.
It is. I mean, when I see the growth and I see the potential and I see the realization of that, it does make me happy. But, you know, I always tell people we're all a work in progress, including myself. So even though I'm a couple of steps or a few notches ahead of you, whatever that means, it doesn't mean that you can't get there or even excel in different areas. We all are here to figure out things for ourselves and to a large degree, really, really try really hard to take others along with us. Because I think the key here is, and I had to challenge myself as well, and I know your show is not about politics, but I challenge myself as well because, you know, I have strong views and I have a family member who has strong views. And I realized the last, you know, few months that we're not going to come to some sort of understanding unless we just understand what the other's understanding. So it sounds weird and simplistic, but it's really about just letting things go because we can agree to disagree.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, I really appreciate your time and you coming on today. It's been a pleasure and listening to you and share your stories. It's been great.
Oh, thank you, Michael. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
My pleasure. Thank you.